So yeah, first in first, thank you all for being here. I'm Sarah, and I have the pleasure and the honor of kicking off this meeting today. I'll be very brief. I'm here just to give you kind of a little bit of information on two things. So what is this workshop about first, and who are we? So me, Paul, and our team here in Marseille enjoying the beautiful weather and working together. So for the first thing, what this workshop is about, let me start with the title directly. So the Symphony of Modern Neuroscience. So symphony, it is meant to represent the fact that in neuroscience, you have different aspects and horizons that blend together. So exactly in a symphony, you have different instruments, the brass, the strings, that create a unified harmony. And so in neuroscience, you have different levels, so the organs, the genes, so really, I mean, biological levels that blend together in an individual, and then this individual can be also in a social context. So this heterogeneity will be represented by our speakers that are the kind of real actors of this day, because they will tackle different sides. So for instance, network theory, computational modeling, and we will arrive towards behavior and cognition in the second part of our workshop. So let me just very briefly sketch the outline of the day. We'll start with Victor Girsa introducing the Victor Brain, and then for the morning session, we'll have Alain Barra, who will switch to network theory. And for our afternoon session, we will have Peter Hall here talking about the Connecton Avatar. Then we will switch to psychedelic experiences with Selene Atasoy. And we will conclude with the groove of the brain introduced by Professor Peter Bruce. The real capping and the real kind of, we hope, topical moment of the day will be our panel discussion at the end, during which we hope we will kind of, you know, interact and discuss together about perhaps hot topics, hot issues within the field. And of course, you're very welcome to participate. And there will be hopefully a lot of participation through Twitter. So that was for our workshop. But here, what we are doing today is thanks to the Imre Institute for Advanced Studies. This institute actually fosters interdisciplinary research as the one we try to perform with fellowships that found residences for individual or teams, like in our case. And more specifically, you can find all the information on their site, where basically you can apply with your own project. And then if you get funded, you can come here in Marseille, work on it in interaction with the local research landscape. And moreover, we'll have the chance to have all our discussion endeavors today recorded and streamed on the Imre YouTube channel. But this was just a little teaser, and for a little bit more of information on what Imre is, I'll just pass the word to the director.
Program of the relation between sciences and humanities. We are a general director and a director of the foundation. You can meet someday.
Yeah.
I just present this program of science and sciences and humanities. There are three axes. The first one is exploration in details of experiences of interdisciplinary research. We try to analyze the conditions for success of interdisciplinarity. So I think that your seminar is plainly in this domain. And the second program is how different audience, ordinary people, other scientists and the like, what is the reception of the scientific results, mainly when there are uncertainty in the domain? If you are in a complex domain, there are usually a kind of uncertainty, and the main reception of this uncertainty in the public audience is, well, skepticism. And it is a misunderstanding of what is the real effort of scientists. And the third one is the relation between digital humanities and research, digital researchers in the simulation domain and the like. And so, of course, simulation is also at stake here. And the final, the fourth axis is about cognitive science and in a large sense, that is from neurology to communication and of course language and the like. So if you are interested in to participate to this different program, you have of course we would be glad to welcome you in this seminar and cycles, and to you can send me a mail in order to make contact and to try to build the workshop, seminar, and conference of this program. Thank you.
Thank you to you. So, yeah, indeed, if you're interested, all the info is on the website. And so, more practically, our team, we always stay kind of in the music metaphor, so it's called quintets, is in the same way of our workshop today, a blend of different expertise. So we have Paul, who is basically in the middle between physics and neuroscience, Timoteo, who is more into dynamical systems, Louis David and Enrique, who are more our neuroscience guys, and then me, that I'm kind of more in signal processing. So we are at the end. Without further ado, let's start this day. Just a little thank you to the Imra Foundation again for actually founding and providing the support for all this. The speakers, of course, that kindly will kind of be the actors, the real actors of these days. And of course, a big thank to you who are here, and also people who are following us, we hope there are many, on YouTube for following this workshop. So thank you so much, and let's get it started. So, our first speaker, if you please kind of approach, is Victor Dietz. He is the director of the INS, so the Institute of Neuroscience des Systèmes. And today he will talk about the neutral brain. You have your own computer already, everything is on.
Perfect.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Sarah, for the introduction, and thank you to all organizers for the for the kind invitation and giving me the chance to speak here. So, Fiat Lux. Et voilà. So I was asked to speak about the virtual brain. I was also asked to stay in time, 10:20, 10:19. And then I looked at what you're doing, actually, what the goal of this quintet here is. And I really liked, it's not on here, the title that you gave it, Symphonies, the transit to the comparison, the metaphor, maybe even more than metaphor to music. Then I also saw what type of speakers will talk. For instance, afterwards, Alain will probably give an introduction to concepts in network theory, topological. We will see. Yeah. So I will try to address several of these issues. I didn't know these things when I gave you my abstract. So yes, I will talk about epilepsy. I will talk about epilepsy and the application of the virtual brain, but mostly I will introduce you to some of the challenges we will run into when we perform system network modeling inspired by the brain. That's roughly the idea. And usually I do not start with a slide, but let me do this here in this case. Because I wanted to show you, when you talk about symphonies, we talk about essentially a spatial-temporal problem. And what does it look like in the brain? And here we, in Marseille, we have also in other epilepsy reference centers, but Marseille, we are recording stereotactic EEG for epileptic patients. It's being used for the exploration of their epilepsy and their individual spatial-temporal organization of brain activity as reflected in neuroelectric signals. This is what you see here roughly on a time scale of about 20 seconds. Here you have a representation of the topography of the brain, and each line represents a point in the brain representing the neuroelectric sampling at this particular point in 3D. And turn your attention to this particular area that is considered to reflect seizure onset, which is actually in the prefrontal areas of the brain. And then it starts recruiting in an oscillatory fashion other brain areas that are mostly located here, continuing to recruit the temporal lobe, areas in the temporal lobe, disengaging and reorganizing in a highly non-stationary fashion their oscillatory pattern. So when we are looking at network dynamics, spatial-temporal network dynamics in the brain, it means in the first place spatially distributed, occurring on multiple timescales and in oscillatory fashion. It's not a onset-offset of static brain states. We are talking about an oscillatory spatial-temporal phenomenon. And that already imposes very specific constraints for this type of network sciences. First of all, it happens on the large scale. What is a large scale? Yeah. Large scale is not individually scalable. When I use the expression large, I mean, as opposed to non-large, there are qualitative differences that enter into the organization thereof. And one of them here is the fact that you have transmission speeds from one area to the other. And those start playing a role when you get to their finiteness starts playing a role when you go to very large scales. Because on small scales, you do not have that. And that enters a highly non-trivial element into the spatial-temporal organization thereof. Number one. Number two, in the case of a brain, at the end of the day, we do not care about the brain. What we care about is behavior. We want to understand the behavior by studying the brain, or dysfunction, or misbehavior, yeah? Through studying the individual spatial-temporal activities. Recognize it's highly non-stationary, and also recognize that in this particular human being, on the behavioral level, this was linked to here, this regime. There the person was only sitting. There the person started coughing, touching her nose, crossing the legs, started singing, started rhythmically moving her upper body, and started interacting with a nurse that entered. In fact, I will show you this behavior. I just want you to appreciate for a second, this is what this patient's implantations look like. These individual time series, this was a mistake. These individual time series, that are being measured here were recorded at these points here in the brain distributed. That's why it's called stereotactic. And this is the seizure that accompanies the spatial temporal organization that you have just seen. She's sitting quietly. This is coughing, touching the nose, started singing. Now we're going recruiting the temporal lobe and start rocking rhythmically, crossing the legs, clapping. Nurse is coming in and the patient is interacting with the nurse interacting with the patient, the nurse trying to figure out to what degree the patient is conscious and will be able to recall what is happening there. So, take out the tongue, reaction, etc. This is what you just saw in terms of brain activity. This is considered to be a prefrontal, or this is a prefrontal seizure. This is what is happening in the brain when this behavior is displayed. Why I'm showing this to you is to appreciate the complexity of what we're looking at. Yeah? On the one hand side, this is pathological. On the other hand, these are movement primitives, behavioral primitives that you encounter in everyday life. Bella, bella, singing, pulling out the tongue, etc. These are movement primitives. So this coding thereof is also in the oscillatory pattern that I showed to you. So this is a reality we have to deal with. And there is a spatial-temporal evolution to it, so it's highly non-stationary. So to speak about individual brain states, as you did, my dear Quintet, in your abstract, is very difficult, because what does it mean? What is the definition of a state? Yeah, how does it evolve? How do we distinguish individual states, etc.? Key question. I don't have a good answer, so, but I'm pointing it out. You will have present one later? Very good. Now, from the modeling perspective, there are multiple ways to approach this. Our team is also part of the Human Brain Project, in which we have taken a bottom-up approach towards the modeling. But that means on the subcellular, cellular level, and taking a constructive approach in the sense, if you can build it, you gain some way of understanding. Yeah? There is also a pragmatic aspect to it. If you can build it, build a generative model, then you can run it under different configurations. Then you can use it as a platform for hypothesis testing, for instance. So there are multiple points to that. Whether understanding in the concepts comes directly from that is a different question. And well, it's definitely contributing to understanding. I'm very comfortable to subscribe to that. This goes under the umbrella bottom-up approach. What we have here on the right-hand side is a project that has been funded by the initially by the James McDonald Foundation, now by other entities also, that is supporting a top-down approach in which essentially the idea is the following. Rather than the microscopic entity being the neuron, you collapse all the neurons into what we call a neural ensemble, a population, and you can apply so-called mean field techniques to characterize the overall behavior of the population of neurons by collective variables. We have successfully done this in thermodynamics, thermostatistics. Concepts such as temperature does not have an equivalent, microscopic equivalent on the level of the Schrödinger equation, yeah, for instance. However, it's a very useful collective variable to describe macroscopic phenomena. Yeah. The idea is the same, and we are applying the same techniques to arrive at a macroscopic level that is low dimensional, 2-3 state variables characterizing a network node, as opposed to multiple million state variables describing the behavior in one population. So that's the approach we have taken in the virtual brain, and that is obviously complementary to the approach taken from a bottom-up perspective. I want to, in the following minutes, I'd like to show you some of the concepts that, that are coming out of this, and actually what the what we want to gain, or which type of understanding we want to gain through this type of approach. And then we see how long it takes and how the talk evolves. Rather than dealing here with thousands of different connections, as we will do mostly today, I reduce the network topology now to a very simplistic one, to a toy model. Yeah? What we have here is a two-dimensional network, local area network that has intracortical connections, typically connection density exponentially decaying. Yeah? So local connections only with no time delay, and one big fat fiber connecting two distant areas where the transmission of signals is characterized by time delay due to finite propagation speeds. This is a step towards a large-scale network representation that plays a particular role. We could include them here also, but typically, due to the short distances, it doesn't matter. That's a very good representation. And then in the visualization that I'm going to show you, we can cut through here. So essentially, you have the following. You have a one-dimensional line with nearest neighbor connections and a two-point connection. And in the simulations, first of all, if we just look at the equilibrium or the oscillatory state, we can do this even mathematically. We can perform linear stability analysis and compute the bifurcation diagrams. I show this to you here computationally. This straight line here with these state variables and in color-coded, I'm plotting here. Here you have a representation of the two-point connection. And I will systematically increase the distance from here to here. It will become, I think, 30 and then 45. If the short-range connections are sufficiently short, what that is equivalent to is an increase of the time delay. Or you can view it as an increase of the distance. It has the same effect. Key here is that I'm not changing the network topology. I'm changing one parameter, in this case the time delay, that reorganizes the system spatiotemporally. So here you see the activity, and here I'm plotting it in a space-time plot. It separates, and now this will change longer, d equals 30. System starts oscillating spatiotemporally with the characteristics spatial wave frequency and temporal frequency, and then it reorganized itself again, and it undergoes a very long transient until a new spatial-temporal pattern starts dominating. This can be done systematically, and then essentially, here as a reminder what we just did, it saturates. Each network node is, for the experts in here, just a fixed point. Linear, stable, fixed point, and all complexity in here comes through the network and its topology and the time delay. Saturates, increases the distance, organizes, not saturates, becomes stationary spatial-temporal oscillation, and again after a long transient. And when you do it systematically, and this is what we can do on the computer, where I use this distance here as a control parameter, and I systematically increase it, and then I just plotting the final stationary pattern that you see here that corresponds to this one. This one would be somewhere here. This corresponds here to the final one. And here, for instance, you see completely black. There is no oscillatory pattern at all. The only state that is stable is the equilibrium state. And you see individual bifurcations that the system is undergoing, meaning a bifurcation implying here that for the same degree of parameter change you have here, nothing quantitatively, qualitatively changes. It's a completely different situation here at this point. Yeah? So, in fact, oscillatory patterns, non-oscillatory, highly, very rich repertoire, given that the network node dynamics is trivial, just a fixed point. Yeah? And all that is being mediated here is essentially the time delay. So that gives us some appreciation of what can actually happen in large-scale networks that have the additional component of a time delay. So what do we want in the virtual brain when we go from the single neuron dynamics to the mean field dynamics is the following, as illustrated here. The two-dimensional toy model that I just showed you, we systematically parameterized it. Yeah. But here I'm doing a full network model composed of individual neurons, again, for the experts, Fitzjuhn-Nagumo neurons, I don't know how many, 100,000, yeah, something like that, having the same connection topology I showed you. And here the reduced model, reduced to 100 state variables, mean field modeling. Two parameters. One is the time delay that we just discussed. Another parameter is the distribution width of the thresholds. Each neuron has a threshold, a firing threshold. This one does not have to be identical, it can be distributed. That's a parameter. If it's narrowly distributed, we are here. If it's widely distributed, we are here. You can put, now you can perform the simulations and you can compute a degree of synchronization. So the strength of the coherence between two areas, in this case it was the two areas that were connected by this two-point connection. And you can compute that degree of synchronization, and it's plotted here. High degree of synchronization. And as you change the parameter, you see this wave-like structure. As you increase the spread of the distribution, yeah, so it's a heterogeneity that we introduced into the system, so or parameter dispersion, you see that we have a degradation of the overall synchrony going down to very low synchrony in these areas, so a gradient, yeah, that still maintains this periodic structure. And then as a proof, as an example, we introduced apoptosis, if you want, neurodegeneration. We thinned out the number of neurons in the network, so they became more sparse, neurodegeneration. And what happened is the wavy structure disappeared, but the gradient from the left to the right still was maintained. Now we go into the mean field model. The mean field model you can run on the laptop. This here you have to run on a highly powered workstation due to the factor 1000 in there in terms of dimensionality. What we obtain is essentially the same behavior, wave-like structure, gradient, and thinning out via neurodegeneration. We are changing the landscape of the parameters. Wave-like structure is lost, but the gradient from the left to the right is maintained. Essentially, qualitatively, we maintain, we can scan the behavior here of the entire network. We're not losing any qualitative information. However, quantitatively, of course, it doesn't fit anymore. But at this point, we don't care. Now imagine, take this as a concept and carry this into a very high-dimensional brain network with thousands of areas, millions of connections, very high-dimensional, that we, on the mean field level, that we want to systematically study, run simulations, etc. At this point of description, it becomes feasible. At this point of description, so for the full brain, it will become feasible in 10 to 20 years, purely computationally, in terms of power, it will become feasible, but we are not there yet. Yeah? This is the key concept around which we'd like to operate in the virtual brain. One issue with regard to time delays, which is very specific for large-scale brain network modeling, are, so as I said before, time delays matter in large-scale brain networks. And we have many thereof in the brain. When you look at the distribution of the fibers that you see here of a connectome, in one sentence, what is a connectome? It is the complete set, in this case, structural connectome, the complete set of all the white matter connections between different brain areas. And we can reconstruct it individually for each human using diffusion tensor weighted imaging, in short, DTI, that allows us, which is measuring the myelination of the white matter fibers in the brain using magnetic resonance imaging. That allows us to reconstruct the fiber skeleton, and when co-registered with the appropriate topography, again from MRI, we can build a brain avatar, if you wish, which has individualized, personalized information in there. This is now the complete network, And on the network node level, what we need to put are these population models that we spoke about. This we can build. Each fiber, given the length, look, 15 centimeters. If we have 1 meter per second as a propagation speed, or 1 millimeter per millisecond, the longest fibers here have about 150 up to 200 milliseconds. These are typically the very long fibers that cross also the hemispheres, but there are also intrahemispheric fibers that are 10 centimeters long. This gives us time delays on the time scale of, let's say, 100 milliseconds, for purpose of argument. Time delays in oscillatory systems. In non-oscillatory systems, they do not matter. In oscillatory systems, they do matter. If we have a prominent rhythm in the brain, is the alpha rhythm, 10 hertz, period, 100 milliseconds. If we, when do time delays become important? When they start approaching something like a quarter of a period, 25 milliseconds, let's say 20 milliseconds. This is when they start playing a role, destabilizing the system, changing the nature from excitation to inhibition, etc. So we are in this regime here. So, and you see what we have are two peaks. One peak, one cluster. This is a weight coming from DTI, and these are the length. So we have one cluster of many, many connections that are here, and another cluster of connections that are here. And those are intra and inter-hemispheric. Now you can take this type of network and start organizing that and ask what type of role do they play. We know time delays matter for synchronization properties. How do they impact the synchronization properties? And here you have an example. We have that was some work with Spasa Petkovski in my lab. He has collapsed it into individual toy models and characterized the fibers. Here you have two scenarios, how the connections are distributed within these two clouds, that we can actually mathematically treat it, and they can be approximated by one time delay, this cluster, and a second cluster that is here by a second time delay. And these time delays you have plotted here, tau 1 and tau 2. This is the coupling strength. And here you see now the representation of the synchronization patterns. You have a cross-section through here, which is plotted here. And what you see is underneath, you have incoherent behavior. Above, you have synchronized coherent behavior. And in between, you have bistability. For the same parameter set, you can have the same type of behavior. And now you change the connection network topology from here to here, for instance. Here you have only interhemispheric fibers with the tau 1, tau 2. You can systematically change the type of synchronization patterns of the system. So if you talk about the effect, the functional or dynamic effects upon off networks or off connectivity upon oscillatory networks, and time delays are in there, you cannot talk only about connection topology or connectivity, yeah, but you have to talk about the space-time structure of connectivity, their spatial topology, and their temporal structure, which happens to be the distribution of the time delays. Otherwise, doesn't make any sense whatsoever, at least on this level of description. It's one of the messages I wanted to get across. Yeah? Another message I wanted to get across. I started 10:19, so I speak until 11, right? Yeah, is that the idea? Yeah, okay. Yeah. Another message I wanted to get across is connectivity and structural features, individual features in the connectivity, as we can pull it out from neuroimaging data, matter, and they have a predictive value in patient modeling, for instance, in brain network modeling. Yeah? And nowadays, we have access to this type of images. Yeah? So these are images here coming from Maxime Guy's lab here in Marseille, obtained with a 7T MRI scanner, highly resolved images, connectivity, topography. Out of this, we can produce our brain skeleton and brain network skeleton. And the details that are in here, they have impact upon the network behavior in the spirit of the type of mean field modeling. Yeah? And this I wish to discuss with you. I was supposed to talk about the virtual brain. Let me introduce what the virtual brain is. The virtual brain, in fact, has started about a little more than 10 years ago when Randy McIntosh put a grant together, of which we were PIs, with a McDonald Foundation that initially put the network basis together, the theory behind the validation and imaging for brain connectivity. And then in 2010, we decided that we need to build a neuroinformatics platform because at that time, definitely at that time it was true, there was no single lab worldwide that individually was able to build such a brain network model. Either they were lacking the numerical, the skills of numerical algorithms, or they were lacking the imaging capacities, or the capacities to build the signal analysis methods to do the DTI, etc. Something was always missing, so we decided to build the virtual brain, a neuroinformatics platform that was built. And he's a head of programming, and Petra joined us in 2012 that developed the learning platform on there. So that has resulted in some review papers and now found some funding from other sources, in particular also local sources, the SAT and Amidex. Yeah? And essentially, it's here you have some images from the platform. It's an open source platform that has been programmed in Python. It's a community project. Everyone can contribute to that. And I looked up this morning. At the moment, it has more than 5,000 registered users. Essentially, it runs on a laptop. We run it also on our high-performance cluster whenever we want to do large parameter sweeps. Yeah, and it allows you to go from the neural images to this type of brain modeling that I will demonstrate you. And here you have two visualizations coming directly from the virtual brain platform. And please note, it runs in your browser. So the web interface is actually so I run it in Chrome here, but there is also a direct Python book interface, etc., where you can work with that. Yeah. Proof of concept. There are some applications in the human. Most of the work has been done on the resting state, yeah, because much of the imaging has been done in the resting state and then applied to questions such as stroke, aging, schizophrenia, epilepsy. Different groups have picked this up. There is a very strong group in Newcastle that is publishing on this a lot. We've been working on epilepsy, and it's being also carried into the mouse for the mouse brain for animal validation. This is headed by Christophe Bernard, also here in Marseille. These are some preliminary results from Francesca, who's in the bag. I have three students here, and I'm pleased that you're here, because all three of you will be mentioned by name today. So Francesca is number one. I didn't know they would come. Yeah, so that's good. Yeah. And she's working with a mouse, putting the mouse into the virtual brain, and this tractography performed on DTI data directly on the mouse, as compared to tracer data coming from the Allen Institute. So one of the key problems is the variability in the connectivity data. It's vast. Does it have really a predictive value? Does it have a predictive value on the individual level? Yeah, big questions. And what metric do you use in order to validate that? Fit experimental data against theoretical data. So first results are coming here, where you fit functional connectivity coming from the experimental mouse data and the simulated mouse data. And when you build the virtual brain of the mouse with the Allen connectome, so tracer data, you'll get the best fits. Individual connectome, next best. Then you can have other connectomes from different mice, but not individual. You lose fitting fit, and when you start averaging, you lose more and more correspondence to real world dynamics. So this here is the first proof of concept that allows you, that demonstrates that the DTI data have some personalized information in there that we can use for predictive value. Yeah? What is it exactly? Ongoing work. Yeah. So I was talking about the network connectivity and the topology that we're dealing with. Another key aspect is when you connect the structural features of the network to the dynamics they can support is essentially boiling down to the question, what network model, network node model you put on each network node? Yeah? Does it not matter? Does it matter? To what degree does it matter, etc.? And especially when applying it to epilepsy, we are running into the issues, as I showed you earlier, highly non-stationary. I can put just a blind oscillator there, or I can put very detailed biophysiological models. Is that important? Because I want to make the link to the underlying physiology. But does it matter on the network level? Very critical questions. Yeah? And we have addressed this in the following. This is the organization that we use in the human brain. Typically, it's characterized by a first order, so it's a field, meaning there is a spatial component, temporal component, first order derivative. This is a vector, a neural field vector, typically, can be up to 12-dimensional. Local dynamics, this is now what we are interrogating, what is the dynamics we put locally. Then local dynamics in the, connections, so the nearest neighborhood connections. And then the connectome that communicates between the amongst the nodes in the network via the time delay. This is the organization. And this is a paper coming from Yves Morda's lab, Jean-Marc Goyard, who's now in Marseille. They have done a nice computational study, also with some experimental validation. And this is coming from a review paper they had a couple of years ago, where in this is a cartoon now, but they nicely demonstrate the major findings. If you have for a biological model a three-dimensional parameter space and you try to classify the contribution of the parameters and the subsequent emerging behavior, then for the same type of behavior, you develop a manifold of the same type of behavior, representing many different parametric realizations that give rise to the same type of behavior. Here you have a different type of behavior. When you look at this, which one do you choose? In a physiological model, there are many different realizations. You could say, I choose the average. If you choose the average, this is the average of the type of behavior of the same realizations for the type of behavior you have here, you're off the manifold, which means you're actually not reproducing the behavior, which means the average contributes absolutely nothing. You have to know the shape of the manifold. Number one, and the distribution of the behaviors, the parametric realizations leading to the same type of behavior. Number two, something whenever you leave these manifolds, there are different ways of to leave it, either gradual or it can occur via state transitions, the type of bifurcations you have seen in epilepsy. Yeah? This is one of the insights that the second one, when if it's a state transition, a bifurcation as we see in epilepsy, then we are actually capable of, rather than building all these physiological models and capturing all the parametric realizations, we can actually build generic models, so-called canonical models that are specific for this type of transition. Yeah? And they are not linked anymore to physiology. However, they are generic, and every physiological model must be mappable and translatable on the generic model. The key idea behind that is for network communication, yeah, and the emergence of the spatial-temporal dynamics in the system, we do not necessarily need to know the underlying physiology. It is sufficient if we just have the good and the right representation of the network node model. This nonlinear dynamics, no. And this we can do systematically. There is mathematics behind that. And through this, I have to go a little faster now. Here, this is experimental data. Hippocampus in tutu in the Bernal lab. And this is multiple minutes here. Yeah, the hippocamp has been placed into epileptogenic conditions, so it discharges. And I'm going to zoom into this one here, which you see here. Seizure onset, And the evolution you see, the inlets that are demonstrating the organization towards the end, seizure offset, an emergence of a spike wave complex. And I'd like you to appreciate the following. You have silent periods, fast oscillations, silent periods. In a cartoon, fast discharges, slow equilibrium point, fast discharges. In math, you can describe this through an alternation of periods of rest and fast discharges. We talk about fast and slow manifolds. And there is a mathematics behind that called the math of fast slow systems that is actually capable of describing this and quantifying this. This type of behavior can be mapped in its so-called state space and looks as follows. It's always a spiral. Resting state, entry bifurcation, fast discharges, offset. If you study this systematically, you can actually build a set of individual bifurcations that tell you how you enter into the fast manifold and how you exit into the exit the fast manifold. Yeah, so it gives you 16 classes, and here you just have some examples of some of the bifurcations that we encounter, but you can do this systematically and you have a complete representation with different behaviors. Because each bifurcation, and that's why it's generic, has very characteristic behaviors in terms of amplitude, frequency, baseline jump, etc. And this can be done systematically, and in particular it has been done, this is my second student, Marissa, Marie-Louise Saggio, who's just writing this up. She's done that systematically, extracted one of the, for the experts, Koda mentioned three, Bogdanov-Takens system, a representation of a generic model, in fact, leading to the postulation of a slow variable that Davide Lillo, the other one, student, is working on and trying to identify physiologically. Plays a very, very important role because we can now represent all the type of behaviors in the classes in the taxonomy. In this case, in a two-dimensional parameter space, essentially it's three-dimensional, but we can derive a two-dimensional representation. And here you have the critical lines giving rise to different class changes. And this can be compared to experimental data. So you have a zoom in here, in this section. We're zooming in here and you can represent amplitude and frequency, and here you have from the model individual transitions when you go from one critical line to another line, bifurcation to another bifurcation, this seizure onset, seizure offset, you find different types of behaviors, and this you can do systematically, and a colleague of ours, Bill Stacey in the US, has gone through more than 2,000 seizures and quantifying this systematically and identifying that there is one dominating class in there, 75% of all the seizures fall into here, and 15% into another one. This year was, Marissa, saddle node homoclinic bifurcation pair. Was that node? Supercritical hop. Okay, thank you. Yeah, so that's this one, and this one then was the saddle node homoclinic. Yeah, and in experimental data, for instance, it looks like this. Yeah. One of the interesting elements here is the slow variable actually drives you from one state to another state. So you cross these bifurcation lines, but it can take also other paths. But it's not arbitrary. Why? Because it's generic. So it has to obey a certain topology. So as there is a slow variable, it actually can go only through certain sequences. Non-trivial prediction of the behavior you can find in the network. And here you see one example coming from a seizure of a patient where the frequency was constant, and then it changed its class where it went up, and the amplitude here went down, characteristic for a particular bifurcation, and then it changed its bifurcation class. There are other types of behaviors. These are experimental data. And you identify the seizure classes and how the slow variable drives it through. And you can represent the types of behavior, predicting baseline jumps and demonstrating others that are not present. So with this, we now have a network node model that we can place on the epileptic brain. And I have 5 minutes. Okay, good. Yeah. So connectivity coming from DTI, individualized. A network node model, generic, capable of describing onset, so changes of brain states, which we know happens to be generic. Yeah, and we apply it here to epilepsy. Let's put all this together and build individual brains. And this is now mostly for illustration purposes. Work that is ongoing now in our laboratories, I should say, here in Marseille, together with the clinic. Fabrice Bartholomé plays a very important role there, Maxime Guy. So this here is a patient here from Marseille that was explored with electrodes on one hemisphere and two electrodes on the other hemisphere. Her connectivity was reconstructed. Connectivity is a topological feature. This is a topographic feature. These are the weight matrix from the connections coming from DTI, left hemisphere, right hemisphere, interhemispheric connections, time delays.
And in addition, this patient had a hematoma in the hypothalamus that was linked to her epilepsy. And that we need to parameterize in particular ways that are not entirely obvious because we do not know exactly what effect it plays. So what we need to do, given that we have a generated network, we can actually test multiple hypotheses, such as connectivity, excitability, etc. This is what we did here. So you see the local connections of the hypothalamus coming out of the hematoma that are displayed. This allows us to build a personalized brain network model where we can make the distinction between epileptogenic zone, as we saw in the beginning, where the seizure starts, where it propagates to, but these propagation zones are typically areas that are not epileptogenic anymore. This is the target of all surgery, but you saw oscillations in there also. How does a surgeon know that he, she has to extract only this and not all that? If you remove the entire brain, definitely no seizure anymore, strong neural deficits. So you want to minimize resection. Yeah? Example, these are now the data in the patient. This was resting state. You find interatrial spikes. And Christian Denard is our local expert for the identification of the interatrial spike, in particular working with MEG here in Marseille. Each time series in blue represented measured here, and the energy that is scaled, that is in this rectangle, is scaling the diameter of the little balls that you have represented here. Seizure, a local seizure, a simple seizure, is charging here on this hemisphere. And zooming in, artifact, organization into a spike wave complex, as you saw it in the hippocampus of the mouse, and seizure offset. So this is the point where you start identifying the seizure class and setting your parameters in the generic model as a starting point. Yeah? And for the same patient also had complex seizures that started here and then propagated to the other hemisphere. So, one thing very quickly in the remaining time, we can first of all fit parameters to the model, Bayesian inference, and that allows us to fit parameters of epileptogenicity coming from the clinician's interpretation and from the data fitting. Yeah, there we use a Bayesian inference framework for that allows us the fit for these parameters. And once the parameters are fit, we can use this and systematically explore the system. These are simulations now. At the same areas for the fit parameters, I've never changed a single time now the parameters. This is all coming out of the network model, seizure organization. For the same parameters, you can either propagate from one side of the hemisphere or not, recruit the other areas, as you see here, and terminate this. So here you see the same, in the movie. The seizure propagation and the spatial-temporal organization. With this type of pictures, we started the lecture and we are stopping it. Starts, propagates through the thalamus and hypothalamus. hippocampus and recruiting temporal lobe on the left-hand side, parahippocampus, showing a very detailed spatiotemporal organization as observed in the patient, all for one parameter set that becomes the fingerprint of this particular patient. This works not only for this patient, but we have first studies for 15 patients that, like in the mouse, when we modeled it with a patient-specific connectome, we get the best fit, in this case against clinical hypothesis. And when we use controls or surrogates, the fitting goes down. And it also fits favorably against clinical prediction and surgery outcome, which means if there are differences, and green areas are the differences between what has been done in terms of surgery and what would have been predicted, and we fit this against a surgery outcome, that is angle glasses, it's called, seizure-free, bad, non-seizure-free at all, then we find a positive correlation. Okay? So this is being used now essentially as a predictive tool, and we are running studies with many of our colleagues in order to understand better the spatiotemporal organization as explored by SVG. I'm running to the end. I think I'm still good. There are many people that are involved in this type of project, clinicians, in particular here headed by Fabrice Bartholomé, colleagues from the Virtual Brain Group, and students, colleagues, and friends that are at ENS, and of course, very important, that helps to pay mostly their salaries. Thank you very much.
So the dynamics you describe in terms of epilepsy, can you find them back in a healthy brain? What I mean is that the temporal organization of the patterns that you observe that are epileptiform, which are very abnormal, in the same brain, could you find the same type of dynamics but with other type of oscillations or normal patterns where linked with cognitive processes?
We have not attempted to do this, but this taxonomy of seizures is essentially based on oscillatory onset and offset behaviors. Okay? But obviously, the math behind that knows nothing about epilepsy. Yeah? These are fundamental theorems in dynamic systems, and it could be easily applied to other brain states. Examples would be sleep spindles that show this type of transient behavior. That are characteristic for sleep patterns. Or up and down states. I think we will have a talk on consciousness today. And there are beautiful work by Mavi Sanchez in Barcelona that is looking at the conscious correlate, the correlate of consciousness characterized by this type of oscillatory. We have not done this yet systematically. I do not know a single reason at the moment what should hold us back in order to do this, because the principle remains the same. Except maybe in epilepsy, we have very strong arguments that there is a slow variable that guides the system on a long time scale. This variable may, of course, will be multifactorial, but that guides the system through this seizure that has fast oscillations, and the duration of the seizure is typically longer. So we have a very good time scale separation. The other types of behaviors, especially if the duration of this oscillatory state, like the sleep spindle, is much shorter and becomes short with regard to starts approaching the scale of the oscillation frequency such that you have only a few periods in there. I don't there it may become difficult, yeah, because there is that a bifurcation? Probably not. So you would have to look deeper into the concept, but also deeper into the data. We have not done that yet, but actually the Human Brain Project, Mavi Sanchez was here, we start exchanging data, and we start thinking about how to do that. In principle, nothing should hold you back in doing so. However, you should not do this naively. Whenever you see an oscillation, this here applies. It's not the case.
No. Other questions?
I can probably do without this thing.
Oh, it's for YouTube.
Oh, hello, YouTube. this is super. It's great. I'm wondering, can you do or at least simulate in some way tasks or sensory inputs? Because one of the interesting things, well, there are many interesting things. One thing would be, for example, try to see whether you're already capturing some sort of multitasking. If you multiply the number of inputs you're giving, do you see separation of activity in different areas? For example, as it's seen when you're driving and say listening to music and so on. So I was wondering whether one could already try and glimpse something of this sort of separation of activities and so forth, which has all the cognitive interpretation you might want in terms of, you know, resources and so on.
We would love to do that, but I'm actually very cautious in doing this, because I don't want to overinterpret this. Because what do we do at the end of the day? We are looking at spatiotemporal dissipation patterns, and it's energy propagation, and there are so many other things in there. However, Andreas Spiegel, for instance, in my lab, applies this to oddball paradigms. Mm-hmm. And data, as observed in EEG, has also looked at stimulation patterns, TMS and TDCS. And there, we are still close to energy dissipation through the network and oscillatory patterns. So there, it works actually surprisingly well. I was surprised about the oddball paradigm, and I'm still not entirely convinced. There are many questions. But this is a place where it starts to become a little loose. So, because there are many other aspects, we are going into this direction. Us and colleagues of ours, Gustavo Deco, for instance, is also looking now into cognitive tasks, but it's in development, in brewing. No firm results to be reported at the moment. The stimulation results start becoming solid. But that's, if you want, not still far away from any form of cognition. Sorry, I cannot tell you more at the moment. Yes.
So, well, since we are kind of running out of time, let's thank our speaker again.
Thank you very much.
And for our next speaker, I'm leaving the floor to
Marco. Thank you, Sarah. So next speaker is Alain Barat, which is senior researcher at the Aix-Marseille University. And so among the several projects that Alan led, I'd like to mention the social patterns, which is the project that opened the way to the contact networks or temporal networks, which is the topic of the talk of today by Alain. So Alain, you have the floor.
Thank you very much for for this invitation. So I'm not at all working in neuroscience, also I kind of hope that this will change in the next years, because I'm starting to develop projects with people actually from the lab of Victor. And so we hope if we manage to get some funding to develop a common project, because we have, by discussions, uncovered that we have really a lot, many interesting problems in common, and that the huge amount of data coming from neuroscience could really be very interesting for somebody coming from maybe a more theoretical background, such as myself. So I'm indeed working on networks, and what I want to give you today is kind of an overview of what has emerged in the last 5 to 10 years about the need to switch from a static perspective to a temporal perspective when we talk about networks. And so, of course, networks, you know that from a statistical physics point of view, it's a very generic concept. You just basically any system that you can represent by a set of nodes joined by links, a statistical physicist will consider that as a network and as an abstract object. And the fact that it is so abstract is, for us, is an asset because it means we can apply tools of network theory and graph theory to describe them and to compare them and to find properties. So just to give very few examples, of course, there are examples at many different scales. So for instance, this is a transportation network at the planetary scale. But there are many other examples, of, such as social networks. This one also is a planetary scale, but of course, social networks can also be simply in a small community or at the city scale or whatever scale you want. And of course, there are many, many networks of interest for biology, such as food webs, for instance, that are, can be described as networks, where nodes here are species of animals. And of course, we've heard before about brain network. So what has really led to the emergence of a large community of scientists working on what is called network science is the possibility to look at many data sets coming from many different fields and describing many different systems, and this possibility to apply to them this common network representation and language. So that there's even now, since probably more than 10 years, a Network Science Society, and that's a very well-known conference. If you don't know it, I encourage you to look at this yearly conference, NetSci, which this year is in the US, and next year will actually be in Paris. We are organizing the next, the 2018 one in Paris. And this this conference, actually, that's a main conference, and it's also many satellites, and there, in particular, one satellite about neuroscience since a few years. So, as I was saying, a lot of studies have worked on networks from all these different fields, and what has led to the... One of the facts that has prompted so much interest is that there are empirically very different from random graphs, which was a paradigm used in graph theory and on which mathematicians have uncovered a lot of interesting features. But the fact that it was different from these random graphs made it even more interesting, because it was important to develop new tools to characterize this data, to find in which sense they were different from random, what kind of structures were there, how could they be explained? How do you explain the emergence of these structures? And what were the consequences of these structures on what is happening on these networks, for instance, propagation phenomena, synchronization phenomena, etc. So just to give, since I want to talk more about temporal networks, but I want first to give a few of these characteristic features which are so common, because then we will see kind of a parallel in temporal networks. So the most well-known probably is the small world property, meaning that in one of these networks, even if they are very big, you need only few hops, few intermediaries to go from one node of the network to another one. And at the same time, these networks are also often highly cohesive, meaning that you have lots of triangles. Basically, what is known as the clustering coefficient measures how many triangles there are around one given node. And you can understand the point in social networks. For instance, your friends, if you take two of your friends at random, very probably they are also linked by a friendship relation. Another very important point which has been found in many networks is the fact that they are heterogeneous, meaning here that they are, here I think the example of the airport network and the American level, and you have what are called hubs with many, many different connections, and you have also very small nodes with very few connections, and in fact you have a whole distribution in many, so here we have a social network, this is the internet, this is the airport network, you have broad distributions of the number of connections, which are typically often modeled by power law tails, and in particular, which are most importantly very different from an exponential distribution. So basically, you don't have then any characteristic scale. You have very strong fluctuations between different nodes, between the connectivity of different nodes, and that has, of course, a lot of consequences on processes on networks. There are also other types of structure that have been found and on which there is a lot of literature. And just to mention them, because I will also in temporal networks, I will come back a bit to that. There's a huge literature on communities, meaning groups of nodes that are more tightly connected than with the rest of the network. This is a very important concept, but also very difficult, because there are more or less as many methods to find communities as there are network scientists interested in community detection. And of course, it's not a mathematically completely well-defined concept, meaning that if I give you a network, you can find different types of communities, and it's difficult to find, to understand if what you have found is relevant or not. So in certain cases, it's quite clear. In other cases, it can be less clear. Finally, another type of small-scale structure that has been of interest are what are called motifs, and basically they are very small subgraphs that you can find in the graph much more often than what you would expect by just by random chance. So then there you want to interpret these motifs as, for instance, building blocks of your network, and probably you want to look behind this motif, beyond this motif, to understand what is the significant, what is the meaning of this motif, for instance, in terms of biological relevance. In here, this paper was about biological networks. So, all these aspects, which are purely structural, at that level have also an impact on how processes unfold on network, of course. And there have been many studies on that, many different actors. Just to want to cite one point, because it's maybe the one of those that has been that have been more studied. If you consider a spreading process on a network, so for instance a disease spreading, which you have people who are either healthy or infectious, and the healthy people can become infectious by contact, and then they can become susceptible again. So this is a typical model for an illness that spreads in a population. If the contact structure of the population is homogeneous, for instance, it's just a random graph, you meet randomly other people, it's very well known since a long time that you have, depending on the parameters of the transmission and recovery, you have a transition between a phase in which the disease just disappears and a phase in which the disease continues to spread in the population. Well, that's a very well-known feature, but unfortunately, when you change the structure of contact on which the disease spreads, then the story changes dramatically, and your epidemic threshold, this is called, so your phase transition, is pushed to zero, meaning that whatever the parameters of the disease, it can actually spread. So this is a dramatic effect of the fact that the structure is very different from a random graph. So this is just an example, but of course, for different processes, you have different impact of these structures, and for different type of structure, you have also different impacts. For instance, if you have a spread in a community, since in a network with many communities, since inside a community you have a lot of links, it spreads very easily, but then to go from one community to another, you have few links, so it is less easy to spread. So from that point of view, the spreading would be hindered by a community structure. So this just to give a very brief summary of 20 years of people working on static networks. And of course, networks actually change over time, and that's what is interesting to me in this
experience. So to go beyond static network, I mean, the reason to go beyond static network, basically the reason that in many cases we have data on this form for many different kind of networks, which are in fact just a static representation of something that is actually changing over time. So each link here is just tells me that there is a contact between A and B, but it does not tell me anything about when this contact has taken place. And it might be that in fact there is a non-trivial order of the contacts between these different nodes. So it is very interesting anyway to look at static network representations first as a first approach, and in many cases it is anyway relevant because we have, for instance, processes that that occur on different, very different time scale with respect to the network reconfiguration. And so if the it should be in the other direction. If the network reconfiguration is very slow, then of course we don't really care that it changes at all. But in some cases it is very relevant. For instance, this is a network of contacts between children in a primary school, and this is a static view. And each node is represents a child, and the link between two children tells me that they have been in contact at least once during the 2 days in which we took data. However, of course, they were not always in contact during these 2 days, and in fact, this is just a static view of something that occurs temporarily. So, in some periods, they are interacting just inside their classes, for instance, and in other periods they can interact during recess or lunch break, they can interact between different classes. So we have clearly lost some information by just looking at this static network. In brain networks, it's also certain that the functional connectivity changes over time. So when you look at a functional connectivity network, often you are just looking at an average over a certain time, and in fact, this information, if you measure it in different time windows, is changing. So it could be also very relevant there to look at the evolution of this functional connectivity network. And it is, from what I understood, it is one of the most promising, relatively recent directions of this functional connectivity study. So very often we have networks that are dynamical, and of course we have to go back to the start and trying to understand how to characterize these temporal networks, how to find the signature of the temporality, how to model these networks and understand what happens with dynamical processes that occur on networks. So, of course, there are still relatively few tools and it's still very open. I want to give you just an overview of the tools that have been developed in the last year by various groups. So, a temporal network is a set of nodes, and instead of having a set of links, I have a set of events between two nodes. So, for each pair of nodes, I can have events that occur at different times. Equivalently, I can look at an adjacency matrix of a network that varies with time. So we have timelines for each node, and we can represent that as the events as some links between the nodes at specific times. We can look at timelines of links. And of course, we can, and that's what we have been doing for a long time, we can represent at different levels of detail and aggregate over time these temporal networks. And of each step in aggregation corresponds to a loss of information. And of course, it's very important to understand what level of information we want to have in our data set. So for instance, assume we have a full temporal network. We can, if we just aggregate over time for a certain over a certain time window, we have a static weighted network, and we can still get a bit of temporal information, for instance, encoding it into the weight which could be, for instance, the number of events between two nodes. Then we can even forget about the weight and get this unweighted static network. Or we could also, and that's done a lot, for instance, in epidemiology, keep information about the weights, but forget about the specific identity of nodes and links. So basically here, what is called a contact matrix, I'll give you an example that is the easiest way. So let's assume we start from our temporal information on the contacts in between children. I can aggregate that and encode this temporal information, like the contact durations, the number of contacts, in the weights between of the links between nodes. And then I can group here the nodes according, for instance, to their class. And then I get the contact matrix, which gives me the average time spent in contact between a child of a given class with a child of another class. So here I have only average values, and this is very little information. I also don't know who has been in contact with whom, and I don't even know how many links there were inside each class or between two classes. So that's basically, if you reduce here to this only possibilities, it's like you have either maybe too much information in the whole temporal network. Sometimes you don't need all this information, but these representations, maybe they forget too much, meaning that you forget really even the density of links inside each class, and you forget in particular the heterogeneity of links, meaning that some people have spent much more time than others in contact. So what we have put forward is an intermediate representation, so there are probably other intermediate levels of interest, but we have shown that this, what we call contact matrices of distributions, can be of interest when we want to model spreading processes, or also when we have incomplete data sets. So the idea is very simple, is basically to say that instead of just the average here of the contact duration, we should put distributions of weights, for instance, of the duration of events, but also of the time between events. So there are certainly other ways to summarize temporal networks and to represent such complex data in a less with sometimes less dimensions, but that is certainly a direction of interest. So when we have this temporal network, what are the signatures of temporality? Where is the time really important? So first, in static networks, we certainly know that we can define path between nodes, and path basically are order sets of nodes and links, and from one node to another one you follow a set of links, and that's your path. So you can then have the notion of shortest path, what is the path through, to go from one point to another that traverses less edges. That's very simple and very convenient, but in temporal networks we have a problem, because if you want to go from one point to another, you have to do it causally. You cannot go back in time. So your path now has to be time respecting, and it means that instead of having just the link here, I0, I1, you have to specify the time at which you are going from I0 to I1, and you cannot go from I1 to I2 before you go from I0 to I1. So T2 has to be larger than T1, etc., etc. And so you now have a path which is a sequence of events, each event having a departure node, arrival node, and time. And you now have two important quantities, not only the length of the path, that was just the number of edges traversed, so it would be just the number of events going from I0 to I5, but you have also the duration of the path. So you have now shortest path, but also fastest path, and they don't have to be the same. So time-respecting paths in temporal networks have much more properties than than usual path. In particular, they might not be reciprocal, so you might be able to go from I to J causally, but that does not guarantee that you can go from J to I causally. It's not always transitive. You might be able to go from I to J and from J to K, but not from I to K. For instance, you can imagine that all the events to go from J to K are before the events going from I to J. So it means if you are in I, you can go to J, but then all the events to go to K were in the past. And also, well, you have a long list of issues with the fact that this path depends on time. So it can be, of course, of interest also to count paths between nodes. And there have been a number of works to generalize centrality measures like between S centrality, which is well known in static networks, to temporal networks. So to illustrate this issue, the reachability issue is just the statement that from a node I at time t, you can reach causally a set of other nodes, and you can be reached by another set of nodes, and they might not be the same. So for instance, here if you have temporal networks A, B, C, D, and on each edge you put just the time at which this nodes were in contact, you see that if A has a message, A can transmit to B only at time 6, and it means that D cannot be reached, basically, because all the events in which D is involved are before the time at which it reaches either B or C. So if you didn't have this temporal information, you could think that A could send also the message to D. Once you have this temporal information, you know that it's not possible. So of course, temporality matters and order matters, at least in a number of applications. Another important point that has emerged, another characteristic that has emerged in temporal networks is what is called burstiness. So basically, here you have a timeline of events on a given link, for instance, and the simplest hypothesis would be that you have a Poisson process in which at each time the probability to that there is an event, that there is a contact, for instance, between two individuals is constant. And then if you look at the number of events as a function of time, well, basically you don't have much change, and the distribution of times between two events is an exponential. So you never have to wait very, very long between two events. However, and I will show you some examples, what has been observed in many cases, in many networks of interest, and in particular all networks that involve human behavior, is what is called bursty behavior, that comes from turbulence and intermittency, in which you can have bursts of activity, so many events very close in time, and then you can have long periods of time without anything. And the distribution of times between two events turns out to be broad and closer to a power law, while in the Poisson process it's an exponential. So there are measures of this, that's not so important, those are a couple of interesting references. But what's important is the consequence of burstiness, and basically is what is called the burst weighting paradox. I don't know if you know it, but basically if the burst is assumed to be every 10 minutes, so you in a Poisson process basically, or in a regular process, the average time you wait would be half of that if you arrive at a random time. But of course you know that it's not true, you wait much more than that. And the reason basically is that if you are deviating from a regular periodic event, then if you take a time at random, you have a larger probability that you arrive in a period in which is long between two events. So you have a larger probability to arrive at a moment in which you have to wait a long time for your bus. So if you translate that into processes on networks, for instance, diffusion, It means that some information that is going, that is diffusing on the network, when it arrives at a node, it will, with larger probability, have to wait a longer time to be transmitted again to another node than if we had a Poisson process. So it tells you that typically this burstiness will slow down a diffusion on temporal networks. What about structures? So I've talked about communities, I've talked about motifs, and of course these properties have been, the structure have been generalized to temporal networks. For temporal motif, there are actually two definitions. I didn't put the reference, but there's a preprint which is quite recent, last year. If you're interested, I can give you a pointer, which is called temporal motifs also, and of course with a different definition, just to be nice. But the idea behind is relatively similar. The point is that you are looking for sequences of events that repeat more often than random. And here, since we have events and not links, it means we have to think about other motifs, and also we have, for instance, to limit the events to events that are not too far in time. Because basically the point is to try to find events that might be causally related, for instance. So just in one figure, the idea is that here, if you have A calling B repeatedly, you specify a maximum time between events, so you keep only the two first, and then you abstract the personality of A and B, so you look for the temporal motif would be all the sequence of two events between two nodes that are separated by less than three time steps. Or here, it's a bit more interesting. Maybe you have one calling A calling B, and then B calling C, and C calling B. These papers are about call data. So then the motif would be the fact that one specific person calls another one, and then you have an exchange of two calls between this second and third person in a quite short time window. So the idea that here there could be some causal relation between these events. Another possibility to detect structures is what is called the tensor, non-negative tensor factorization, being proposed by Laetitia Gauvin and collaborators in Turin. And basically, the idea is you have a representation of the temporal network as a tensor, which is basically you, at each time step, you take the adjacency matrix, and then you have the time dimension, so you have a three-dimensional tensor. And then you have techniques to represent this as a sum of simpler elements. And each element will be considered as a component of your temporal network. And basically, in this product here, you have, on the one hand, the membership of a node to the component, so a node could belong strongly to a component, less strongly to another one. But you have also a timeline. So it reminds a bit of the community business, except in communities you would just have that a node belongs to one community and that doesn't change over time. Here, it could belong to a community that exists for a certain time and then disappears, for instance, because you have this timeline. I will show you an example later. So empirically, what do we do when we have temporal networks? Well, when we have static networks, we have you can look at a number of statistics. You can look for communities, motifs, distributions, etc. And when you have a temporal network, well, first you can do the same. You can just look at the aggregated network on a certain time window and look at all these static features. Are there heterogeneities in degrees? Are there communities? Are there motifs? Whatever. And then you can also compare on different time windows because your network is evolving. And they can be larger and larger, or they can be successive, for instance. If you imagine we have data on several days of contacts between individuals, we will naturally compare the different days. And then you have some properties that are specifically temporal, like, for instance, the distribution of the contact durations or the distribution of intercontact times, which gives us the idea of burstiness, or temporal motifs, or temporal structures, like covered by these ones, for instance. So, just want to show you some data. For instance, in a number of networks, you obtain that this the statistics that you observe in different time windows are typically independent of the time window. So this is, for example, the evolution of the US airport network. And if you look at distribution of degree, of weights, of strengths at different months, basically you see the same. While, in fact, this network is indeed evolving. If you look at the average degree, it fluctuates, and you can see that there is, in fact, a lot of activity. And in particular, if you look at the duration during which a link between two airports is active, or the interval between active periods of a specific link, you find broad degree distribution. So this is the burstiness I was talking to you about. At a totally different scale, we have similar properties in face-to-face contacts, so measured by our sociopatterns collaboration. So here you have the dynamics of the contacts during one day of a conference. And if you look at the statistics during different periods, here this is statistics of contact durations, you find basically the same distributions. And this is also the distribution of intercontact durations. Here it's in different contexts of human contacts, and you find this burstiness shown by the broad distribution. However, there is evolution. So in particular, you can ask what happens to this aggregating network when I start changing the time window of aggregation. And for instance, here we see that here it's in the primary school. So as a function of the hour of the day, we have 2 days of data. If we look at the average number of persons that have been in contact with a random individual, we see that it is growing. It is fastly saturating inside each class, but then each child will have contact with other children in different classes. And so you see that even if the statistics of the network basically are the same, if you look at different time windows, there is clearly some evolution. So it's important to try to find, for instance, how much this evolves, and to try to quantify, to try to find specific structures, temporal structures, specific time windows of interest. So there are very few tools typically heuristically applied. For instance, you can compare successive time windows with different measures. You could have just a Jacquard coefficient. Here we have a similarity measure between networks aggregated in different days, and then you want to compare that with null models. For instance, here we compare the similarity distribution of individuals in different days, so how much do they contact the same person in different days, and we obtain a certain distribution which compare with various reshuffled null models. This kind of comparison has also been applied in this interesting paper to try to automatically find moments in time in which something is happening in your network. In fact, they use basically a simpler measure of similarity, just a Jacquard coefficient, but basically they look at different and growing time windows, and whenever there is, basically they maximize the overlap between successive time windows, and when they find a maximum, they consider that something is happening at that point. Another application of these structural findings, for instance, here you look at temporal motifs in mobile phone call networks, and you find that the most representative motif with three nodes is this one in which a person calls another one, then a third one, and then a third calls the second, maybe to check what the person has said. So then you try, of course, to rely on that to give some interpretation to these motifs. Finally, in terms of finding structures, this is an application of this non-negative tensor factorization by Laetitia Gauvin and collaborators to the data of the school. And basically, what you find using this data, you find a number of components. Certain components correspond to the classes, so you found again the community that you could find using just a static aggregating network. But you also find some components that are not classes, in which many children of different classes participate, and they correspond actually to finding the lunch breaks of the first and second days. So this you could never find by just looking at an aggregated static network. How much time do I have? 5 minutes. Okay. So there have been, of course, also a number of attempts to model temporal networks. This field is also pretty open, I would say. There's a very interesting model which is called the activity driven. It's extremely simple and maybe simplistic, but that is acknowledged by the authors. The point is that you can also do analytics because of thanks to this simplicity, and then you can build on this very simplistic model to make it more and more realistic. So basically, here at each time step, you have nodes that create links and then forget about it at the next time step. No memory, no correlation, it's kind of toy model, but you can do a lot with that. And it has been made richer by introducing a reinforcement mechanism that actually exists in data. So the paper is this one. And so here you have some memory on the nodes you have been in contact before. And there are also, that's a very interesting paper with a number of additional mechanisms to make it even more and more realistic. Finally, just a few words on processes on temporal networks. Lots of studies have considered toy models such as deterministic spreading processes, and basically one of the interests of using these toy models is that you can compare what happens with these spreading processes or random walks on the data you have and on null models of the data, and then you can understand what each temporal property is doing on your process on the network. For instance, as I was saying before, it has been shown that burstiness slows down the spreading, while temporal motifs can favor spreading. For instance, if A calls B and B calls C this immediately afterwards, this would favor the transmission of information. There have been a number of papers on spreading processes on networks, for instance, to compute the epidemic threshold by Eugenio Valdano and collaborators. We have worked a lot on the impact of the data representation, meaning how much information do you need, basically, how much temporal information you need to correctly inform your model of spreading, depending on the type of model. And a number of also of strategies to immunize networks, to immunize nodes in networks, to find structures in networks that are crucial for the spreading process, and so where you would like to intervene if you want to hinder the spreading process. So I hope to have convince you that it's a very interesting field to delve into. It's very, very open. Most of these issues are, there are some pieces in the dark in which we have started to understand a bit, but a lot has still to be done in terms of how to find structures, how to find timescales, what to do when your data is incomplete, what kind of networks, network models are of interest, and how the temporality impacts processes in networks. So I'll finish by just showing you a few references. Basically, if you're interested in this field, the first point of entry, so that's the very famous review by Peter Holmer and Yaris Aramaki, which is already from 5 years ago, but it's still a good entry point, and a more recent entry point by Peter. And basically, I would recommend to look at all the papers by Peter and Yari, who are probably two of the most prominent scientists in this field. In this one is also edited by them. This is a book with many chapters by the relevant persons. And if you're interested about more face-to-face human interactions, our website is sociopatterns.org, and we've also published a number of papers on that. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Few questions.
Yeah, thank you very much for a very interesting talk. We have data which really fits in your view, I think, which is epileptic discharges happening in different brain regions. So these are events that happened unpredictably. And we'd be very interested to try such methods. So the first question we have, when we already tried to look at networks between events like that, is when do you decide that two events are actually linked? I think this is what you mentioned when you said about the temporal window. So do all the methods need this temporal window? Can you infer it from the data, or do you need to try different windows to decide that two regions are actually, the event correspond to the same thing?
So the data I've been working with are relatively simple in this context, because there is an event or there is no event. So it's binary. While I think that what you refer to is that you have correlations, you measure correlations, and then you have to fix a time window.
We can also binarize it. We can detect events, and then okay. We'll be just there or not.
Data, we start at time zero at a certain time and end at a certain time, and you analyze what you have. Mm-hmm. Of course, then, if you have a different time window, the network could be different and have different properties. And I don't know if I put here, but... what I think is very important is to design ways to compare data sets to tell if the network is the same or not the same, or whatever this means. And even in static networks, it's not obvious, meaning that you can look at statistical properties and find that they are the same, but the network is very different. So we need to have a kind of hierarchy of properties and to be able to say these networks are similar at a certain level, in some sense. Now, what I've presented is always cases in which we start by having a network that is temporal. I think what you are asking is from data, how you go from data to this temporal network. And that is field dependent.
Yeah, we have some... Say you have two regions and you have random events. I mean, you've presented things like that, like your Poisson processes. And then we have to decide if these two events are related or not. And there some time window comes into play. We need to say if events are separated by less than 20 milliseconds, then we decide it's the same. There is the same in neuronal spiking also. If you have recordings of neurons, you have to decide that these spikes are communicating together.
Until now, it's arbitrary. Mm. I mean, also here, when you look for temporal networks, you just put an arbitrary time window.
Okay.
So that should come from external information.
External information, yeah.
External knowledge.
Thanks.
Okay.
Thank you, Alain, for your lecture. There is another distinction we have to be careful with, and I'd like to have your opinion on. When comparing data sets and looking at temporal networks, it's one thing to look at their temporal evolution, and then you apply your tools in order to obtain topological representation thereof, and to have a representation of their temporality. Now, when you go to the models of temporal networks, the generative models of temporal networks, the following situation can happen. When you have linear generating models, then it's straightforward. You have a one-to-one mapping between the structural properties and the dynamics, because there is only one single trajectory, meaning temporal network sequence, that can occur. Nature is nonlinear, yeah? And what can happen is that for the same structural network, yeah, you don't change anything at all, but the system is nonlinear, you can have multiple trajectories, or in your words, you can have multiple sequences of temporal networks occurring, but the underlying causal structure, the causation process itself, coming from the structural networks and the dynamics that is sitting on each network node, will be identical. How do you deal with this issue? Because on the one hand side, you have different temporal networks applying your measures, but at the same time, the underlying causal generating mechanism has not changed at all. In this sense, the generative mechanism of the network itself is static. So it's the same network, in other words, just the nonlinear features that are expressing themselves through this multi-stability of possible temporal evolution. Sorry for the slightly convoluted question.
No, but
maybe you have a less convoluted answer.
It's a bit the same with models of static network, in the sense that you can define a generating mechanism that can give rise to many different networks, but the generating mechanism is defined as such.
Sure, but how do you deal with it in the data?
I think that what's crucial is to do what a number of people are working on currently, is to define ensembles of neural models and hierarchies of neural models, and then you want to fit your data to a model, and you want to have it's the same, I think, with static data. If you have data and you want to know which model fits the best, you always have this criteria.
Okay, so you're proposing for model comparison,
yes.
Data fitting, yes. Your answer.
The problem, of course, you have much more property than in static data, so in some case, of course, the model is much broader, but
okay, so let us thank both the speaker again. So now there is a lunch served upstairs. The room will be locked, closed, so you can leave everything here if you want. So back at 1 p.m. Thank you.